Welcome back to Chemistry Matters and the third video on our Unit 8 playlist, Thermodynamics. In the previous video, we learned that heat and enthalpy are the same under constant pressure, which means under our normal atmospheric conditions, and that a process can be either endothermic, meaning it absorbs heat from its surroundings, or exothermic, meaning the process gives off heat. We also saw firsthand that different substances, while at the same temperature, can feel colder or warmer than each other and can actually melt ice at different rates. And speaking of that, by now you should have developed an explanation for why the metal surface in our lab melted ice more quickly than the plastic. In this unit, we're going to learn why different substances transfer heat at different rates and efficiencies. We'll also learn about calorimetry, a method of measuring the quantity of heat transferred in a process. Right now, let's head back to our classroom to see how our students explained the melting ice mystery.
You've had time now to develop a scientific explanation for the observation that when they're at the same temperature, the metal block melts the ice faster than the plastic block. So who would like to present their explanation for that first?
We will. We thought about how metal pans are used to cook food. It must be because the metal transfers heat so well.
So we think the metal block transferred its heat to the ice better than the plastic.
To put it in science terms, our hypothesis is that different materials have different heat conductivity, kind of like electrical conductivity.
That's a good start. And what you're talking about is thermal conductivity, which is a measure of the ability of a material to transfer heat. And the higher the thermal conductivity of a substance, the faster and more efficiently it will transfer heat. And the thermal conductivity of metals are quite a bit higher than that of plastics. So how about you guys? How did you explain the fact that the metal block melted the ice faster than the plastic?
I think our explanation is pretty similar to theirs. We did a little research and read that plastic is a huge molecule with all of its atoms bonded to each other.
Right. And the metal is more like a bunch of unbonded atoms whose electrons are free to move around.
Heat is transferred when particles collide with each other. We drew our model to show the atoms' electrons in the metal moving more easily than the molecules in the plastic.
Good. You guys are off to a great start. Could you explain your model to us?
We drew our model to show that the electrons in a metal are freer to move around than the electrons in a plastic. And because there's more movement, they can transfer energy, in this case heat, to the ice cube better.
Great. Both teams are off to a great start. Heat is, in fact, conducted through substances by way of molecular collisions and molecular vibrations, as you mentioned. The greater the temperature of an object, the higher the kinetic energy of its atoms and molecules. Heat can be conducted through the transfer of this kinetic energy. For example, the faster the particles are moving near the source of energy, some of their kinetic energy is then transferred to the particles that are moving slower until all the particles have the same energy and then are therefore at the same temperature. And some materials transfer kinetic energy more effectively than others, and therefore they have a better heat conductivity. But there's another property at play here besides heat conductivity. If we were to measure the temperature of the two blocks after a certain period of time in contact with the ice cube, the temperature of the metal block would be significantly lower than that of the plastic block. You might be able to tell this just by touching the blocks for yourself.
Yeah, I can tell. The metal plate feels a lot colder than the plastic one.
Is that because the metal gave more energy to the ice cube?
Yes, that's right, Caleb. The difference in temperature between the two blocks is related to the property of specific heat capacity that I mentioned earlier. This tells us how much heat energy it takes to change the temperature of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. Specifically, the heat needed to raise the temperature of 1 gram of a substance by 1 degree Celsius, as I mentioned, is the specific heat capacity. The standard units for specific heat capacity are joules per gram degree Celsius. Now, substances with a low specific heat capacity are more sensitive to changes in temperature, like the metals here at the bottom. Substances with a higher specific heat capacity, they're more resistant to changes in temperature. Water, for example, has a very high specific heat capacity, and so it's quite resistant to changes in temperature. And again, look at the metals and how low their specific heat capacities are. This explains why they're so quick to change in temperature in the presence of heat. It takes more than 8 times as much energy to raise 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius than it does 1 gram of iron. That's a lot more energy.
You might be wondering why this is important. Why should you care about specific heat capacity? For one thing, the effects of specific heat capacity are all around us. Literally. The air around us has a relatively low specific heat capacity, and as a result, changes temperature quite readily. It's the difference in specific heat capacity of land and air versus water that explains why the temperature of the ocean changes slowly and very little, while the temperature of the surrounding land and air changes rapidly and by much greater amounts. The consistent temperature of Earth's water helps keep the Earth's entire climate steady. The specific heat of a substance must be taken into account before producing almost anything. For example, cookware is made with materials that have a very low specific heat capacity so that they heat up quickly and make cooking faster, although their handles and many cooking utensils are often made of materials with high specific heat capacity to protect us from burns. Substances that must be kept cold are put in materials with high specific heat capacities, such as styrofoam, so lots of energy is needed to raise their temperatures. Now that we have an understanding of the importance of a material's specific heat capacity to the amount of heat transferred during a process, and we've seen the effects of specific heat capacity on solids like metal and plastic, we can turn our attention to the specific heat capacity of gases. The composition of gases in our atmosphere plays a key role in the Earth's climate, so it's very important to understand the role of these gases in heat transfer. The specific heat capacities of gases in general are much lower than most liquids and solids. For example, the heat capacity of air is about a quarter the heat capacity of water, which explains why the temperature of our atmosphere is much more likely to undergo large temperature variations. Earth's temperature depends on the balance between energy entering and leaving our atmosphere. The gases in our atmosphere directly absorb some of the sun's radiation, as well as absorbing some of the reflected radiation from our Earth. This trapping of the sun's radiation by the atmosphere is referred to as the greenhouse effect, and it's the primary mechanism for maintaining our climate at a moderate temperature. If not for the greenhouse effect, the temperature of our Earth would fluctuate wildly. For example, the moon, which is about the same distance from the sun as Earth and has almost no atmosphere, varies in temperature from a high of 121 degrees Celsius to a deep freeze low of about negative 150 degrees Celsius once the sun goes down. The chemistry of our atmosphere must maintain a balance or equilibrium between the incoming radiation from the sun and the outgoing reflected radiation from the Earth's surface. Absorption of some of the sun's radiation during the day protects the Earth from too much heat, and the release of heat from the Earth's surface provides warmth at night once the sun sets. Atmospheric gases such as water vapor, methane, also known as natural gas, and carbon dioxide are primarily responsible for the absorption of reflected radiation from the Earth, and thus are our most important greenhouse gases. However, if the atmospheric greenhouse gases absorb too much radiation, the average temperature of the Earth may continue to rise as more and more heat gets trapped in the Earth's atmosphere. You may have experienced the warmer feel of a very humid day due to the ability of water molecules, the most prevalent greenhouse gas, to absorb heat radiation. Similarly, the coolness that descends over dry climates at night is a result of the lack of water vapor. The variation in the concentration of greenhouse gases has an important effect on our climate. Although water vapor, carbon dioxide, and methane all occur naturally in our environment, the prevalence in the atmosphere has increased since the Industrial Revolution, caused by an increase in the burning of fossil fuels. The burning of coal, oil, natural gas and wood have resulted in an increase in carbon dioxide in our atmosphere of more than 30% since the Industrial Revolution. Average temperatures in the U.S. have increased by about 1.5 degrees Fahrenheit during that same time period. Climate change, such as prolonged periods of heat, heavy downpours, and floods, are consistent with the increased levels of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. So what does all this have to do with thermochemistry? To find out, let's go back to our classroom for an experiment in thermochemistry and how it helps us understand the role of greenhouse gases in our environment.
Scientists have played an important role in environmental stewardship. Studies of atmospheric gases have helped us understand the greenhouse effect. Scientific models of our climate, based on the known chemistry of the atmosphere, allow us to predict what might happen if the greenhouse gases continue to increase. Today, you're going to take on the role of environmental scientist, exploring the contribution of atmospheric gases to the greenhouse effect. Each group has three empty plastic bottles, each of which will be filled with a gas to represent our atmosphere. The gases we'll study today will include water vapor, methane, and carbon dioxide. Nath Krishna and Wyatt will compare water vapor to methane, while Caleb and Alexis will compare water vapor to carbon dioxide. Each group will saturate the air inside the bottles with the two gases that I mentioned. The third bottle in front of each group will simply contain the air as it already does, and this will serve as a control. In order to investigate the ability of each gas to affect temperature change, the gas-filled bottles will be placed close to an incandescent light, which gives off most of its energy in the form of infrared light or heat. Notice that I already put a hole in the top of the bottle caps so that you can insert a thermometer, which will allow you to monitor the temperature of the gas in the bottle over time. Let's go over the procedure you'll use to test your assigned greenhouse gases. To make carbon dioxide, pour 30 milliliters of vinegar into a beaker. Add 3 grams of baking soda. When the fizzing has stopped, carefully pour the freshly made carbon dioxide into the bottle. Do not pour any of the liquid into the bottle. You will not see the carbon dioxide gas pouring. Carbon dioxide is more dense than air and will remain in the beaker until you pour into the bottle. Repeat this procedure 2 more times to make sure that you have enough carbon dioxide. Then tighten the cap on the bottle, insert the thermometer, and seal the hole with the clay. To fill a bottle with methane, or CH4, invert the bottle over a gas jet hose in the lab and allow some natural gas to flow into the bottle for 10 seconds. Natural gas is less dense than air, so the bottle cap, thermometer, and clay should all be added while the bottle is held upside down. Use caution. Methane gas is extremely flammable. Special care should be taken to keep the methane away from any source of flame. And to get water vapor into the plastic bottle, place a piece of soaking wet sponge, at least 3 centimeters in diameter, at the bottom of the bottle. Then, again, tighten the cap, insert the thermometer, and seal with clay. Lastly, your third bottle, our control, already has room temperature air in it. So you'll want to insert a thermometer into that bottle and seal it as well. After all the bottles are ready, record the initial temperature for the gas in each bottle. Your initial temperature will simply be room temperature, and it will likely be between 20 and 25 degrees Celsius. Place the bottles 30 centimeters away from the incandescent light, one on each side, and it's important that all the bottles are the same distance from the light. Use the data table to record the temperatures in each bottle every minute over a period of 25 minutes. Heating the gases inside the bottles with incandescent lights models the heating of our Earth's atmosphere by the sun. We'll mimic the sun setting by turning off the incandescent light and monitoring temperature for an additional 10 minutes. When you finish collecting data, enter it into this spreadsheet. We'll combine all of our results on one page so we can compare the effect of different greenhouse gases on the temperature of the atmospheres inside the plastic bottles.
We'll take a break here to let you perform this greenhouse gases lab and record your results in the data sheet that you can find in our Chemistry Matters toolkit for this unit. And when you're done, and you're ready to compare your results to the results of our students, you can rejoin me at the top of the next video on the Unit 8 playlist.